Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. We'd like to welcome you to St. Benedict's College Annual Speech Day 2013.
Body. In a special way, under the patronage of Our Lady, as she's called Our Lady of Presentation, we present these students to you today. As Mary presented her son in the temple, may she present each single student here with a mother's heart, with a hand on their shoulder, and looking towards you, O God, asking protection, guidance, inspiration, energy, focus, zeal, and excellence for each single student, each soul here. And as we ask Mary, Jesus' mother, we pray for the parents of these students for that same wisdom to make decisions to guide them, to be exemplars to them. Bless them, bless us, Lord. Keep us safe from all harm or danger that are real. Let us not be coward or afraid, but let us be brave, but not foolhardy. Grant us this day joy and a great sense of accomplishment for our college, for our young men, for the teachers and for their parents. All this we ask through Christ our Lord. Amen. Would you be seated, please?
Especially invited guests, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, and students of St. Benedict's College. I will be your MC for this morning with Mr. Light One, my name is Jamil Hassan, and I would like to welcome you all as well to today's ceremony. I'd like to take this opportunity to invite someone whose history is also at St. Benedict's College, a hard-working gentleman, responsible for running, day-to-day running of the school. With us greetings, our principal, Mr. Earl Alson.
My dear students,
Ladies and gentlemen, class of 2013. Good morning and special welcome to our annual speech day, which we celebrate on the 57th anniversary of the establishment of this institution. Ladies and gentlemen, dear students, the past year has been a challenging and rewarding one for us here at the Benedict College. Our fundamental purpose as a school is to create a learning community in which teachers strive to establish and sustain the right climate which recognizes and embraces the philosophy that every child is a child of God, who is important and can be a valuable human resource to the nation. Ladies and gentlemen, children are our tomorrow. Our future. The bright faces that I see this evening, certificates and prizes, will be the citizens of tomorrow. At St. Benedict's College, we submit the teachings of our values and character in education, for we believe in creating lifelong learners who become quality individuals and contributors to the wider society. Today is a day to celebrate human achievement and to give it its due recognition and just rewards. You students were successful in your engagement with the many experiences we designed to prepare you for leadership as well as success. Let me at once congratulate those who have been specially rewarded today for their achievements, for attaining excellence in various fields of endeavor, and for embodying the theme, go, become, live. I congratulate you, my dear students, not only because of what you have done by and for yourself, but also on account of the fine examples you have set for others before here at St. Benedict's College. My dear students, sustaining excellence is always a lot more difficult than attaining it. But the true test of excellence is its consistency and reliability. And it is in this, my dear students, you should demand of yourselves. I especially want to express sincere thanks and appreciation to all parents and teachers present here today. Your role in our school's success must not go unmentioned. I am sure that the prize winners at the class level, and indeed all those who enjoy the fruits of success at the NCSE, CSE, and PIP examinations will agree that you were instrumental in your success. Let us continue to demand and equally encourage excellence in all our students, in all facets of their development. May I add that how we behave as teachers, parents, administrators, and managers influence profoundly the extent to which those who are learning from us either succeed or fail. Ladies and gentlemen, members of staff and students, I pause here to specially recognize and pay tribute to two outstanding teachers who have recently retired from the teachers' service here at St. Benedict's College. Mr. Yusuf Hussein, a former dean of the institution, and past students who have served the government of Trinidad for 41 years,
as well as assisted us to give 38 years of distinguished service right here at St. Benedict's College. We thank them for their long and devoted service to the institution and wish them all the richest blessings in their regards. Can I hear you all?
Stand in line in order to get the attention
Ministry of Education. However, we have had good support from Petrochem and the Pinar Daily Regional Corporation because they assist us in the maintenance of the facilities and departments, as well as they contribute, especially Petrochem, to offer one program here to Benedict, as well as Pinar Daily Corporation remove lots of solid materials from the platform from time to time. I say special thanks to these two corporate citizens. To the Pastors, to the Parent Association, the Pastors Association, and all you individual parents, I want to say special thanks for your generous donations on school projects and your continued efforts to assist with the college. I still feel that we can be more given. Because, as I said, it's a poor school for 70 years old. We need every cent that we can collect to continue providing an enhanced environment for students and for teachers. Ladies and gentlemen, students are schools that help them to pass in their service.
Overall,
72 students obtain 5 and more subjects. In the case of examinations, Unit 1, there were pass rates of over 80% in following subjects: accounting, art and design, biology, computer science, Caribbean studies, environmental science, geography, geometrical and mechanical engineering, drawing, information technology, physics, pure mathematics, and sociology. Of these subjects, it was 100% passes in accounting and in accounting, art and design, computer science, environmental science, geography, geometrical and mechanical engineering, drawing, as well as sociology. In the Unit 2 examinations, there were pass rates of over 80% in following subjects: art and design, biology, environmental science, communication studies, computer science, biology, geography, history, physics, management of business, as well as sociology. Again, there were 100% passes in art and design, computer science, geography, and management of business. Let us applaud all these students.
Thank you. Champions in the championship.
emerge South Zone and national champions. So let's get going.
Grab wonderful. It has been a wonderful atmosphere. Today is truly a great day. A day that hopefully you students will never forget. Because it marks a major achievement as you transition to a new phase of life. Today is a day of moving into a new era, of leaving the old one behind. A day of tears, smiles, hugs, and handshakes. A day when boys become men. A day when students become alumni. Those of you who are 0.6, I'm talking to. To those of you who continue to be with us, or 0.6, let us continue to contribute to the social, spiritual, moral, and intellectual life of the college. And let us, and let our successes be the guiding light for others to follow, like our former and our former tools. Class of 2013, it is the same challenge that so many before you have faced as they walk out of the doors of St. Benedict's College into a world crying out for change. A world in need of innovation, in need of love, in need of commitment, in need of fresh ideas, and in need of fruitful energy. Ours is a world of uncertainty, a world of unpredictability, a world where nothing is promised. So as you begin this journey of uncertainty, you need to have vision. You need to be focused. You need to be courageous. As well as to have a deep and abiding faith in Almighty God. We hope that all of you will graduate as strong global leaders, community servants, as well as well-rounded young adults, and as exemplary human beings. I challenge you, my dear students, to look inside yourself. Pull up all those very qualities and use them for the rest of your life so as to motivate yourself to improve the human condition. You have the opportunity to change the world. You can make it happen one step at a time. As you move into the world, the challenges are there before you. Your experiences here at St. Benedict's College, academic and co-curricular, will empower you to go out and serve with humility and integrity. My dear students, class of 2013, have a vision for your life. Have hopes and dreams and be focused. Because when you do, even the toughest obstacles can be overcome. This is what makes life fun. Gives meaning to tomorrow and keeps you hopeful and upbeat. To you, graduating class, again I say thank you for the honor and privilege of knowing you. May each of you find deep peace and true happiness that come from living life generously and stay close to your God. May God bless you abundantly with all the riches that you deserve. Thank you very much.
Graduate of the University of the West Indies. He
holds a bachelor's and a master's degree in economics. He is a certified graduate in the Kaplan and Norton Balanced Scorecard System. He has also had extensive postgraduate management training at Harvard Business School, M.W. Kellogg School of Management, Oxford College of Petroleum Studies, American Management Association, International Law Institute, and the London Strategic Planning Society. He has had a distinguished career in business spanning over 30 years. These years were divided between two premier institutions, Trinidad and Tobago, Central Bank and the National Gas Company of Trinidad and Tobago Limited, where he currently holds the position of Senior Manager Strategy. In his private capacity, he is the principal consultant with his firm, Venture Strategies Limited. In this capacity, he has facilitated or assisted in the facilitation of strategic plan development for several profit and non-profit organizations, including the Ministry of Energy and Energy Affairs, IGOV-TT, Airport Authority of Trinidad and Tobago, Police Service Credit Union, Workers Credit Union, and Land and General Industry Union. He is also an experienced researcher, having written and published papers on strategic planning, energy industry, technology, transport, trade, and public finance. He has lectured in organizational studies and strategic management in the MBA program conducted at the School of Accounting and Management and the Alpha Logjack Graduate School of Business. He currently serves as a visiting lecturer in energy economics, strategy, and project evaluation at the Department of Economics, UBC Investing. He is a director on the board of the Boy West Institute of West Indies and a member of the Board of Governors of the Caribbean Climate Change Center. Ladies and gentlemen, join me in welcoming our feature speaker, Mr. Gregory Bombard.
Boys and girls of this prayer on my effort is one of many, many things that we have become and simply lives in an impactful life, and therefore is appropriate to speak to you today. And therefore, I think it is, I feel comfortable drawing on my own life experiences to see if I can give you some perspective on the world that we're preparing to enter into. And let me first say that the world today is very, very different from the world of 40 years ago when I was sitting on this. Yeah, I see some people start to make calculations over 40 years. I don't know what it is. Okay, 40 years has passed, and time really passes very fast, as you will discover. But, you know, 40 years ago, we would be sitting here wearing fat pants and Afro hairstyles. Yeah? Kind of hairstyles in front of you. No, that wouldn't touch it. It's big muffin Afro, and so on, and big bags. 40 years ago, if by chance you bought a product from China, you would hide the label. Yes, parents? You would hide the label. There's no way you would do that. Typically, today, everything comes from China. I gave this school in the car, who's a pastor right in the car, whose number was PG1791. PG. In one way, like this morning, coming on was PTB. It's a long time ago. But significantly, that car had something called a tape deck from which we used to listen to record the music. So there's a big factory that you push in to play music and so on. It's called a tape deck. Now, these things are very antique. Now, we don't see that stuff anymore. So, world is changing. Another significant one. The postman was professor at that time. Was sensible to maintain communication with those who live abroad. To make an international call, you either had to go to Port of Spain or to San Fernando to what was then telco offices and line up and you pay your money and bring a booth and so on and your computer connect to you. Yeah? Urgent messages came by something called Telegram, yeah, not an Instagram, Telegram, right? So the world has changed. 40 years ago, this country was on the brink of economic collapse. It was on the brink of economic collapse, and coincidentally, this month, October 1973, was when something very, very different happened. And the Arab world, Saudi Arabia, who owned oil, they decided to embark on an embargo on oil in the United States because they went to war with Israel. And so the US was on Israel's side, as it still is. And so the Arabs decided to punish you by restricting supplies of oil to them. And actually, major increasing oil prices, which triggered a complete reversal of the economic fortunes of Trinidad. You're too young to know this, but that is where this country went through what is called the first oil boom. And life has never been the same for us anymore. So what you see today, and what you believe today is hard times, but you live in glorious times, where there's a company at all with the world that we face back in 1990. which is perhaps the most pervasive change, most pervasive development in the world since the Industrial Revolution centuries ago. You are well aware that the internet has changed the way we live. Its impact is all pervasive. It has transformed every industry and activity in this world. Its impact is clearly evident in banking, media publishing, photography, entertainment, tourism, manufacturing, medicine, energy, pornography. Of course, the one that is most familiar to you, social interaction, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, whatever it is, you're on them every day. So in some ways, you know, I consider myself quite fortunate to have been through all of this 40 years, and thank God for that. On a personal note as well, I also consider myself quite fortunate to have been one of a select group of students, I think, who in some ways have experienced three phenomenal leaders who passed through St. Mary's College. You see, I went to school when Dr. Martin was a postdoc. He left when I was in Form 3 and then came to me from 3 to 6. Between those two, there was St. Mary's College, the longest civil principal, who was both my Form Master in Form 1 and my Form Master in Form 6. Declan Singh, who spent 59 years of his life in St. Mary's College. So that I happen to be, in many ways, everything I do is made up of influences from these people. And I'll never forget my grandma, that I'm also in every way from every influence I've had in my life. Amazingly, notwithstanding all these changes, and I stand here and I look back at these 40 years and look back at my own personal experiences, I have to say that notwithstanding the many changes we see in the world around us, both locally and globally, the principles of success, the principles of decent living, principles of life, fundamental principles of living a good, decent, successful life have not changed. The challenges have not greater, but those principles have not changed. And I have been very confident to share with you a couple of those things here today. I think you've come to that point of your life when you're ready to move to the next stage. Some of you in various forms, those who stay with us going on to Form 6, those who stay with us, those who are leaving Form 6 going on to the private world. And those who are leaving school, some of us, and some of you are happy that this whole business of school is over, at least for now. Others are uncomfortable, but the master's discomfort with the value and the job. Boy, I got this to go. You know this time? That's a lot of bravado, because all it does is hide in my mind inner fear about the uncertainty that you're going to face. But let me tell you that it is okay to be uncomfortable. It is okay to be uncomfortable about change. It is normal. Because what you are going through is what few people recognize. You are going through a stage in your life where you are going to experience one of the most fundamental transitions that you have ever lived. There are certain points in life that you experience transitions. And many people do not prepare themselves for such transitions. And in this instance, I find that neither parent nor child at any time can prepare for the transition. Some of you are going to move from being student to adult, move from student to adult. And this means many different things and challenges for both parents and children, as you can imagine. For example, it is at this stage at which children wish to make their own decisions. So you know, left school and you believe that, well, you know everything, and that you can make decisions about what you want to do, where you want to must qualify to rectify. You must qualify to rectify. So all this passion that you have for what will change the world, you just be giving that to me, and therefore you don't have what it takes to change the world. So it's nice to meet your friends and your peers, but in some ways, I think you need to be your place. You need to qualify for this. So, are you ready for that transition? Are your parents ready for the transition? You know, I met Mr. K several years after he retired, and I asked him, well, how's retirement going? He said, my lord, I never had any problems with retirement, because you know what? I retired too. I never retired. I tell you this because this simple words of wisdom. I was relevant to you because you transition. So if you have to tell yourself, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? Rather than leaving from, yes, you're leaving from the next college. And as you leave the next college, you know, those of you who are leaving, I want to take the opportunity to tell you. And let me just put on my. I have now. I want to take the opportunity to tell you that once I'm in the time, always I'm in the time. And therefore, in my capacity as Vice President of the alumni now, I want to see all students of very much different eras being part of the alumni. And I want to tell you that the more become members and active participants in the alumni. Yeah? But let me get back to the transition. One of the keys to managing this transition we're speaking about, one of the keys to going to, is in fact to have a personal vision of yourself. For example, my friend Mark in the front here, is he? Yeah. Jeremy? Before the mirror, with that, you're comfortable with that. Good. Sit before the mirror and ask yourself, what am I going to be in 2023? What am I going to be in 2023? And to answer that question, I need an advisor to do a lot of soul searching, some introspection. And asking yourself, well, what really is my purpose in life? What is drives me? Because it is only what drives you, that purpose, that inner purpose that you believe you're placed here for, is what will help you define quite clearly who am I in 2023. Take the long view. Who am I in 2023? Right? However, is much more than just saying, well, I'm going to be a pilot. It requires you to envision all that goes around that. The nature of my life, who are my friends, how am I going to treat my family, what kind of life I want for family, what is the contribution I'm going to make to my community, how am I going to assist and live with people around me. Now, when you are comfortable with that broad picture of you in 2023, when you're very comfortable with that picture, you now need to sit down and ask, well, how am I going to get there? Exactly how am I going to get there? And don't restrict yourself about this dream in you. This dream could be anything. You're young, and the big advantage that you have is you can start now and you can deliver. Power to succeed is in your hands. Nobody else is. So create that dream, create that vision. And you know what? One of the biggest advantages of this information. have that information right at the fingertips. So research those steps that you need to get to your destination. But you need to understand one thing. Whatever that destination is, the journey is never going to be easy. You must stumble along the way. But perseverance is the key. As you know, people of my time used to say, where horse reach, donkey reach. And as well children, you all read the story of the hare and the tortoise. Right? So when you embark on that path, you may want to be gripped by fear. In other words, I'm walking on uncharted territory, and therefore, fear is. Just remember that you can never take flight without looking up and letting go. The plane takes flight, it has to lift off from the ground and walk there. If you've got to move up, you can get this feet off the ground. It's risky and it's actually risky, you need to do it. And when disappointment hits you along the way, remember always that there are better things at hand than whatever you left behind. There can be many disappointments. Many disappointments. Thomas Edison, the guy who invented the light bulb, which you should know, said, told us that the greatest weakness among us mankind lies in giving up. The most certain way to succeed is always to try one more time. You know, it's not of course to feel 20 times in this time. But never give up. Or put it another way, another great man, Winston Churchill, says that success consists of going from failure to failure without any loss of enthusiasm. That's the key. That's why I said, get enthusiastic, to get passionate about what you do, really requires you to get to the end. What's my purpose in life? What do I want to accomplish? How can I leave this world a better place than I met it? How can I undo those who went before me? The point of all these quotations is to tell you that the journey is not going to be easy. But your passion and enthusiasm is what will produce. And if you do and understand one more thing, that there are going to be resistance and resistance from people, resistance from systems, resistance from society, resistance from everything around you, particularly when the path that you have chosen seems to go against the norm. But great men and women have always gone against the law. Christopher Columbus, you know that story. Everybody got to it. And maybe he got here by accident. But at the end of the day, he got the system. But there's something that we learned in today's scholarship that's always allowed me to have the courage to speak my mind and do what I want to do. Notwithstanding obstacles, notwithstanding understanding the consequences sometimes that I have to face in life. And that is comes from the other influence of my life to me as well as they can say. And I don't know if this particular line is still used in today's stories. But anybody who experienced the legacy and was only slightly more in class would know that the way of the transversal is exceedingly difficult. So we all have to write that up in times. But you wrote it there as hands, not understanding what it really meant until you arrived in the world and you understood that, well, if I got the system, if I hold it by the root, then there are consequences of that response. And more positive and negative. Just be mindful. So, I want to have a make this says, my boy, you always my boy. It matters not what you pursue. Always remember you like it, do it. But there's always room at the top. That's the only place I can guarantee you there's room. So it matters not my choices in economics or law. It matters not whether you read economics or you know law. There's always room at the top. But remember that. You like it, do it. And there's room at the top. So what did that say? That tells you that you must try it first, and you must try it to reach the top. In order to function, it is important to remember that even as you get to the top, it is only continuous learning and reinvention of yourself is going to keep you at the top. Because when you get to the top, understand that there's no further way to go up, and we tend to get complacent when we get to the top. Uneasy is the head that bears the crown we are told. Do you remember that Mary? Well, that Mary once was the in thing. It was the phone everybody wanted. They were the market leader. They had the greatest sales in instruments. And for a couple of years, they led the cell phone market big time. Everybody wanted that Mary. Didn't have a barrier, it wasn't in the view, it just wasn't in. So they got lazy because they were enjoying being on the job. Last week they were looking for a buyer, looking for something to buy them on. Lost billions of dollars in the last year. So it's not easy to be on top. So even when you get on top, you need to continue getting yourself. I find it really comfortable. Ask the question, how do we live? Is it sufficient to merely follow the norms? Who are the other root causes improving? Beyond material success, what should we be striving for? What should we be exhibiting beyond material? My own view is that living is not a selfish thing. It cannot be a selfish thing. You have to commit to leaving this world a better place. The quality of life you live is not determined only by the amount of money you earn and the material things that you can buy, but the conditions of the community and the country in which you live. The overall conditions of some of the impressive results that they have been stating are really making a huge mistake. Ultimately, directly or indirectly, it's going to reach all of us. And therefore, I think we need to ask ourselves, what are those values that are going to govern our relationship with the world? We live in a society today where we have seen deterioration of values such as integrity, caring for others, that's what honesty, the courage to speak the truth, articulate this speech with the power. What are these things have been going in the wrong direction across the society? And, you know, in thinking about them, I felt that it was much more, one would say, well, you know, we just need to rediscover and honor those values. But I found that wonderful. There's a book called Four Agreements by a guy called Don Miguel Ruiz, The Four Agreements. And I found them incisive, and I found that they were relevant and very important to share with you. And the first agreement is that agreements that you made with you and these are agreements that you sit down and have a conversation with yourself, you say, I want to know. Agreement number one is being impeccable with your word. That's true. speaks about integrity. If you say something, mean it. And avoid using the word to speak ill of others and to gossip about others, to spread rumors about things of which you know nothing. Right? I think it's another way as well. And for me, this also speaks to some of that comes from the Bible, which says, do unto others what you would have done unto you as you want to yourself. In other words, I don't do anything to anybody that they should do, that I don't want to do for myself. And it's fundamental. It's how would you, if you embrace this, how could you go down the road and spread some rumor about someone? Would you like that to happen to you? No. How could you cheat on a football match? How would you feel if someone cheated you? How could you cheat in an exam? How could you fabricate certificates? Like someone who do that, the answer is no. So one has to live with integrity, and one has to speak with integrity. So lesson number one, I remember what you gave yourself. And from today, I shall be ethical with my word. Lesson number two is something that gets us upset and upsets our spirit, and it says, "Don't take anything personally." You know, sometimes people speak. And you'll be leaving the trailer woods for me. I'm not going to be doing it. But the trailer woods for me. Listen, nothing others always be positive. When others say I do things, when others, what others say is a projection of their own reality. This is them speaking. Don't take their word. Don't take their word with you. Don't carry that with you. So, lots of students experience situations where adults tell them you're dumb, you're stupid, or children are stupid, or all your stupid children, all your young people, so on and so forth. Leave them with their problem, right? Don't take it personal. Yes, they may have experienced that what they're expressing is the experiences that they had with others. Is not for you. Don't take that one for you. The third one is don't make assumptions. That's the worst. Someone tells you something and rather than ask for clarification, you assume that you're doing that because you don't like me. Right? This don't like me, sure, this is picking on me. This man, this job, really like my work at all. All the guys said was, well, you know, I don't think that this, you could do this in a different way. You assume that he's doing that because he doesn't like you. So assumptions, as a lot of us say, long time ago, we don't make assumptions taken of you and me. Yeah? So this is not new. So don't make assumptions about that. And the final sure know that wherever you go, whatever you become, however you live, just remember to place God first. Being a little Christian, Christ above all. Thank you very much.
Seems the absent representative of
excellence in mathematics, physics, and communication studies. Simeon Wong. Congratulations, Mr. Collins. For excellence in English language and English literature, Kishore. Thank you. Dylan Espinosa.
So you are to
show and quiz natural. You live well, you live passionately, but you will meet challenges. You are to take risks. And I'm going to tell you something that my director said sometime while you were saying this. Jump and the net will come out. And I find that is so awesome. Take risks. Life. Take your risks. There will be challenges. But take your risks because you can jump and the net will come out. Laugh and love as Jesus loved. And then I want you to live that wonderful harvest that your principal spoke about. I want you to take special notes of the preparation time that Mr. McGuire spoke about. And all
Your pantor, Chris Marks. Thank you.
sticks to science, I invite the students who are present here at this moment to please stand. And from sticks to science, we have Jermaine Aaron, Leslie Anderson, Kara Celeste, Joshua Charles, Joseph Griffith, Aaron Henry, Abdullah Khan, Roman Bachman, Chad Lyons, Krishna Mahadev, Kevin Mohammed, Simeon Wong, Dara Zamanu, Ricardo Smith, Kristen Thomas, Jamal Thompson, Kwesi Valentine, and Hakeem Williams.
Daniel Butler, second place, Owen Lawrence.
one M. First place, Rod Ramadani.
The best of it. To accomplish great things, we must Science.
principal's trophy for most disciplined student, Akeem Williams.
Your last graduation ceremony with us. Last year, speech day was really a high. It is my distinct honor to express heartfelt thanks to all those who made to be possible. In keeping with our motto, the hail of Neo Christo, firstly I wish to thank Almighty God for continually blessing the work that we do at St. Benedict's College for 57 good years. And of course, for allowing all of us to be here present in good health, good spirits, to celebrate this wonderful ceremony. Thank God. To our principal, Mr. Alston, for your fearless and astute leadership, for blazing new trails that we can only aspire to live up to and follow, and continue to blaze further trails, for your critical support, mentorship, on behalf of the entire school community, we say thank you.
Thank you.
valedictorian. Thank you for representing that Benedictine warrior spirit, for showing what it really means to be a product of St. Benedict's College. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
own power.